From the 12th chapter of Luke, where Christ is speaking to a number of people. He's speaking to a great crowd, and he's teaching them some great things, like do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but fear for your eternal soul. And then he speaks about the providence of God, that God provides for us. Even sparrows are not forgotten by God. God remembers even the number of our hairs. Our hairs are numbered in the mind of God. And do not be afraid about martyrdom. They're going to bring you into synagogues and authorities. And the Holy Spirit will put in your mouth what you should say. And while this is happening, there's a man there who doesn't hear anything because he's totally preoccupied. He's preoccupied with a great temptation taking place at home. He feels that his older brother is cheating him. He's not giving him what belongs to him, the land that belongs to him. And he ignores all these teachings, and he takes the conversation from being very lofty, very high, down to earth, and asks Christ, Lord, tell my brother to divide my inheritance, to be fair with me. And in Greek we say, Tainiko, me and Dimo. Here, he exposed his family in front of this great crowd. He shouldn't have done that. This is a private matter. But something was eating him inside, and that was pleonexia in Greek, greed. And Christ sees this in his heart, and he takes the opportunity to teach about the great downfalls of wealth. Not wealth per se, but mismanaged wealth. Wealth is a great thing if it's used properly, but if it's mismanaged, it can destroy and kill our soul. This was totally inappropriate, again, for this young man to bring this up at this very moment. He totally ignored all this spiritual wealth taught by Christ, and the Lord gave us this wonderful parable that points out the downfalls of mismanaged wealth. This rich fool, the word fool is used twice in the scriptures, once in the Old Testament and once here in the New Testament. In the Psalms, David says, a fool said in his heart, there is no God. Of course, a foolish person would only say that. So this man was extremely blessed by God. His land produced extremely well. He had so much material wealth. And perhaps at the end of his life, ready to retire, he says, oh, I have so many things. What do I do? Tragically enough, he asks the same question that a very poor person would ask when they're totally broke. Lord, what do I do? I have nothing. And now he uses the same words because he has a problem. He's extremely wealthy. And he thinks to himself, I got the answer. I'm going to tear down my old barns. I'm going to build bigger barns. His favorite word is mine, mine, mine. My barns, my grain, my goods, my soul. Everything is about himself. And this is a great illness. And this poor, 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 rich, materially wealthy man, but very poor spiritually, he made some serious mistakes. The wealth, because he was totally possessed by it, made him forget God. God is nowhere in the picture. Not thank God for all this. not thank God for the rain, not thank God for my workers, but it's all about him. He totally forgot God, not in his vocabulary. Number two, he totally forgot his fellow man. Nobody exists except him. Not his workers, not his family, not his neighbors, no one. It's all about him. Number three, he forgot that his soul doesn't eat. He thought he was going to feed his soul. I'm going to tell my soul, eat, drink, and be merry because you have all these things. He forgot that his soul was immaterial. Number four, he totally forgot about death. Lost the memory of death. No, he has so much money. Death is not an issue. And this is a big trap. People who mismanage their money and become greedy, they think they're going to live forever. Well, I'm going to at least live to be 100. So I'm going to have plenty of money to retire on. The average American today, they feel they need to have $1.2 million to retire. Why? Because of this trap. Because we think that, no, we're going to live to be very long. He forgot that people become ill. And unfortunately, he forgot who was in charge. And at that very moment, when he's thinking about all these things, God tells him, you fool, this evening, this moment, the demons are coming to grab your soul because you invested all your efforts in their work. You did not become wealthy in godly things. You see, God didn't tell us not to be rich. God wants us to be rich. He wants us to be very rich, but he wants us to be rich in godly things. He wants us to develop shares in heaven. There are shares in heaven. I mentioned this before. When Christ, in the second coming, x-rays our heart, the demons will do the same thing. And if the demons find their shares in our soul, then we belong to them. So they found plenty of shares, greed, selfishness, egocentricity. Last week we saw the Good Samaritan, how he was the epitome of sacrificial love. He sacrificed his own life. He could have been killed by the thieves and murderers that were nearby, but he sacrificed for the other person. That's the epitome of great love, and that made him godly. But today we see the epitome of spiritual poverty and selfishness, who makes us demon-like. So yes, we can prepare our passport for heaven, and we can become rich in God by feeding the homeless, by feeding the poor, by visiting the sick, by helping people out, by becoming Christ-like. The most dangerous thing about greed and possessions and wealth, what makes wealth dangerous, is that it makes us take our trust away from God and put our trust in our belongings. That is very dangerous. St. Paul calls that idolatry. This man basically was worshiping his wealth. And unfortunately, he lost it all, and he ended up losing his life and losing his soul. Let's avoid this terrible example of this rich fool, and let's try to imitate the motto of last week, the Good Samaritan. Amen.